to trade in New York. The deal needs to be done. Now is the time. And look at the markets. The Dow is up, straight up out of the gate. Never look back. It's been strong all session. 0.5% pull the Dow apart. And you see Apple is at the top, along with IBM and Intel. The laggard on the Dow is McDonald's, but it's green across the screen. And these are the drivers of the day. It's technology companies, as you've seen, that's driving the market higher. We'll get into exactly how. Turkey's central bank is stepping in to stop the currency rout. And China says it's happy to talk with Washington, even as Donald Trump says, no pressure. We're live in the world's financial capital, New York City, on Thursday, September the 13th. I'm Richard Quest. I mean business. Good evening to you. Two giant storm systems on two different continents are about to wreak havoc. There's a hurricane in the Atlantic Ocean and a super typhoon in the Pacific. Look, you can see them here on the super screens. You've got the one that is out in the Pacific. Both are just hours away and both have hugely, potentially destructive ramifications. We will deal with both of them during the course of the program. We begin, though, with the United States and Hurricane Florence, which is due to arrive within hours. Now, storm force winds are already hitting the coasts around Wilmington, and of course we'll move on towards North Myrtle Beach. Look at the way the outer bands are hitting, and you think of what's still to come. Let's begin in the southeastern United States. The outer bands of the hurricane have now reached land. Now, this storm is growing in size as it prepares to dump trillions of gallons of water on the Carolinas. 10 million people are under watch or warning, hunkering down or getting out. And bridges and roads are closing. Authorities are warning the window of time to leave is just about closed.
Many of you have been placed under evacuation, and we are asking citizens to please heed a warning. Your time is running out. The ocean is going to start rising along the coast and in the Back Bay and inlet areas and the Sound areas within a matter of hours. Your time to get out of those areas and storm surge inundation is coming to a close.
So, the storm's path. Tom Saters at the World Weather Center. Talk me through where this is going.
Well, currently, Richard, it's 180 kilometers just off the coast from Wilmington. It went from a Category 4 to a 3 to a 2, which is probably psychologically the worst thing to happen because people think it's okay, it's just a 2. It doesn't change a thing. It carries with it all of the severe elements of a Category 4. Now, understand that. We got to go back to the beginning. When this came off the coast of Africa, we got our first advisory on the 30th of August. That's over 2 weeks ago. But for the first time in history, at a lat longitude of this position, the U.S. has never had a hurricane make landfall coming across in this direction. They always go up to the north in the northern Atlantic. So it is bringing with it all of the characteristics it had as a Category 4. That wall we talked about yesterday, that upwelling of water from the ocean, is carried with it. So the only thing a 2 does is it lightens those winds right around the center somewhat. So the unfortunate homes that get flooded will not lose their roof at the same time. Now, this is horrible to think of, but when you look at the cycle, and we've talked about that little eye going through its cycles, that eye wall replacement cycle, they all do it. Every couple of days when it goes through the cycle, it pushes winds out and they stay.
Sorry.
Goes through another cycle, pushes them out. So this is, even though it's Category 2, it is so massive, covering so many states and real estate.
What's this thing I'm hearing from you and others about how the hurricane, and forgive my imprecision of terminology, but how the hurricane will stall over the area, and in doing so, will dump even more water.
Okay, last year, Hurricane Harvey moved into Texas, Category 4, devastating little town of Rockport. But then you could outwalk it. It was a named storm in East Texas for almost a week. It was feeding off its own rainfall. Right now, we're getting winds at Hatteras at 80 kilometers per hour. Here's the stall process, and this is why this is a concern. Moves in by overnight tonight into tomorrow morning. There's Wilmington. That's landfall when half of that eye is over land. But then between Friday morning and late Sunday, it only moves 240 kilometers, about 150 miles. You can outwalk this. Even a tropical depression, when it's got that source of water, will do tremendous damage. The river in Wilmington will probably have 6.5 meters of water. That's all-time record. We're talking all-time state rainfall records for North and South Carolina. As much rain in 3 days that Washington, D.C. picks up in a year.
So, Tom, I know we're going to talk about the super typhoon later in the program, which is also important. But just finally, and very briefly, in a word, we are now in the dangerous time, the dangerous period for Florence.
Yes, we are. It doesn't get much more dangerous than this. In fact, when the window shuts, it stays shut. Those that are going to remain behind, keep them in your thoughts and prayers, because they put the first responders in danger, and many will not even answer calls to 911 because it's too dangerous. So, this is not over with, though, Richard. Once this goes through the mountains, they've had water rescues up to the north for this week because Gordon came through and flooded this area. So this is going to be an ongoing story for a good week.
Tom Slater, thank you. Now, the storm is expected to deliver an economic blow as well. By one estimate, $200 million a day from North Carolina alone. And the reason is, if you look at the storm's path, it becomes quite clear. What's in its way? Well, you've got agriculture, the cotton crops and livestock that are in danger from some of the most important farming communities in the United States. But more recently, of course, the Carolinas have become major high-tech manufacturing and industrial areas. High-tech in those sorts. You've got autos, planes, and food processing. If that wasn't bad enough, take, for example, Charlotte, North Carolina. You have banking, the second largest financial center, Bank of America. It's expecting heavy rainfall and flooding all in that area. And then, of course, tourism. The summer may be just about over, but this is the best time normally to visit those parts of the United States. So businesses are taking evasive action where they can. Ports, factories, and stores are closed. Daimler, Volvo, Boeing, Nucor, Smithfield all have closed their factories too. Boeing and BMW are getting their goods out of the storm. Boeing flew the planes from South Carolina to Seattle, and BMW moved trains carrying its cars into holding areas for safety. Power companies are also bringing in extra workers to get the lights back on as quickly as possible. And pipeline operators are making sure to keep gas flowing, gasoline flowing, through the Colonial Pipeline to the northeastern United States. You're getting an idea of just how devastating this is. Perhaps one who knows more than most, Larry Wootton, is president of the North Carolina Farm Bureau. Good to have you with us, sir. Thank you. The crops, the agricultural, the livestock, how much is at jeopardy with this storm?
Well, certainly this huge weather system that's coming in right now as we speak couldn't come at a worse time for North Carolina agriculture. Agriculture is by far the largest industry in the state of North Carolina. We grow 50% of all the tobacco that's produced in the United States. We're the number one sweet potato producer in the United States. We're number two in production of hogs, number two in production of turkeys. And so with our cotton, peanuts, all the major crops that we grow here, this could not come at a worse time. Our farmers have been working feverishly for the last several days, whether it be pumping down their waste lagoons for their livestock and poultry operations, topping off gas tanks and diesel fuel tanks for auxiliary generation. Obviously, many of these operations have to have auxiliary power generation.
Now, with the crops, are they ready to be harvested? What stage are they at that makes this such a bad time?
Our tobacco crop right now is only 50% harvested. Our sweet potato crop is probably 25% or less harvested. 100% of the cotton is still in the field. Basically, 100% of the peanuts are still in the field. Probably 50 to 60% of the corn crop that we grow in North Carolina is So it's going to be devastating for North Carolina agriculture.
What do you do with livestock in this scenario? I mean, the idea of moving them to higher ground, well, that's not going to be practical or reasonable for the numbers involved. Keep them indoors. Again, the numbers involved are going to be huge. So what is the best solution where livestock's concerned?
Well, with our livestock, in our pork industry, most of those are in confinement operations. Those operations are above the flood-prone areas. We learned a lot from the last hurricanes that have happened. Our livestock and poultry farmers have been working feverishly to make sure they protect those animals. They're working hard. I think we're going to be okay unless you get winds in excess of 100 miles an hour. Then if they begin to take the tops off of these livestock facilities, there's nothing anybody can do. But aside from that, they've got auxiliary power to make sure they have feed and ventilation and water. And so we're prepared.
You're prepared, sir. You're prepared, Mr. Wooten. Thank you. When I say good luck, I mean, whatever happens, we want to find out afterwards how it all went. Be safe, sir, in what could be very difficult and dangerous circumstances. Now, an even more powerful storm is currently about to threaten the Philippines. It's the super typhoon. Look at this. It's also coming in. We'll talk about that with Tom Sater a little later. In fact, half past the hour, in about 12 minutes from now. Now, US stocks, back to our agenda. They gained in the final hour of trade. A nice, strong, good rally. Straight up, not me, all right. Gave back a bit from the 10 o'clock best of the day. But even so, not bad, up 0.5%, 128 points. And it was technology stocks that led the advance. You saw on the chart right at the beginning, IBM was up and Apple was the best gainer on the day, up over 2 to 3%. Investors are hopeful for fresh US trade talks. Kroger shares were off about 10%. Sales at the largest US supermarket chain grew less than expected. The world's richest man has finally announced plans how he's going to start spreading his wealth. Jeff Bezos and his wife Mackenzie are creating a $2 billion fund to help the homeless. The Amazon chief executive had been asking his Twitter followers for ideas on how to give back some of his $150 billion fortune. CNN's Samuel Burke is in London. He's been thinking about philanthropy for some time. Now he's done it. It's obviously, it's a relative drop in the ocean, in the sense of the amount of wealth that he's got, but it is a start.
It is a start, and I think a lot of people in the tech world, Richard, are very happy to see that it's going to be going directed toward helping people who are homeless, shelters for the homeless and schools for the homeless. And I'm specifically saying the tech community is happy about this, because if you look where tech is most successful, I'm talking about Seattle, San Francisco, as well as here in London, you see a huge amount of homelessness. 11,000 plus people are homeless in Seattle right now. So a lot of times when you talk about the success of tech, we don't talk about how the rising house prices have hurt a lot of people in these communities. So yes, it's only $2 billion of $163 billion that he has. Yes, he's been criticized for not previously talking about how he's going to donate a lot of this money in the way that Bill Gates and Warren Buffett has, but it looks like it's headed in the right direction.
And do we know why he has decided on this, why he and Mackenzie decided on this? You make the argument about Seattle, London, New York, and all the other tech centers. Was that the reason?
No, I'll be honest, we don't know why he did it. In fact, just a few months ago, he had been talking about the fact that he didn't know if he would have any money left over from all that he's investing, not in Amazon, but in his other company, Blue Origin. So where this comes from, we don't know exactly. And I think it's also worth noting that there's been extensive reporting done about how tech billionaires in particular make these announcements, and there has to be follow-up. A lot of times these announcements, we haven't seen exactly where the money has gone. So this is a story that we're going to stick with and watch, because there's been a lot of criticism about how the tax deductions have been used. Of course, we haven't seen the money spent yet. We're not making any accusations, obviously, but this is a story we have to follow very closely.
Samuel Burke, who is in London. Samuel, thank you. It is Questions Business Live from New York. When we return, the Brexit Secretary, Dominic Raab, tells UK companies to stop blaming Brexit for their bad results.